of the first New York State holiday was held at United Christian Baptist Church, 713 East 222nd Street, Bronx, New York, 10467. Reverend Reginald E. Paris, pastor, July 8, 2019. Now, therefore, we, the members and supporters of the New York branches of the Association for the Study of African American Life and History, do proclaim this day, Monday, the second Monday in July, Abolition Commemoration Day in New York State. Now, now what happened when I read a little better than this, so people stood up and they applauded. And we were all happy that I decided that everybody there was proclaiming this day, Abolition Commemoration Day. So why not pass it around and let everybody sign it? So that is what we did. And this goes into the history books, okay?
Amen.
And for us to make sure it goes into the history book, we must write it ourselves. That's a part of the responsibility of this organization. And if we don't have, it costs money to develop anything. It costs money. We have elected some officials. We need to see that they help us to get the money we need to do the writing and the teaching we need to do. Okay? If you believe me, may I hear you?
Thank you, Mrs. Jackson. Let's give her a nice round of applause.
Let's give Mrs. Jackson a nice round of applause for work. Are there any questions?
No questions.
Or comments? Okay. So thank you, Sister Jackson, for your, first of all, for your leadership and how we have come this far by faith.
Yes, yes.
And we're gonna continue to fight, and we're gonna hear more about this later in the program through Lucille Boles Wilson, who has been fighting the good fight on behalf of ASALH.
Right. So
right now, on the schedule, I have a memorial for Reverend Dr. William L. Watkins, but I cannot reach the picture at this time. So I'm going to ask for a moment of silence, and I'm going to ask that when we come back from the break, maybe I'll have it better and I can show the picture and what I actually wanted to do. So please, let's give a moment of silence for the Reverend Dr. William L. Watkins Jr., who passed in March from COVID-19.
That was a heart attack.
Thank you. So we'll come back to him and we could do it in a different way. So we're going to move along in the program. And now there's a PowerPoint, Slavery in New York State by myself. Okay, let's see.
It was
17. Okay, Emancipating New York, the politics of slavery and freedom. Slavery in New York State. Slavery existed in New York State from colonial times through the creation of the modern day state. Alexander Hamilton, John Jay, and other prominent New Yorkers owned slaves at one time. But the more reform-minded of these formed organizations to end slavery in New York, such as the New York Manumission Society. Here you will see a for sale sign. And as you can read, it's a likely healthy young Negro wench between 15 and 16 years old. She's been used to the farming, for farming, and they want to sell her inquire at William Street. And the most thing that you need to notice that this took place in New York City, March 30th, 1789. Many of you know about Wall Street being our financial capital of the world. We started the finances at Wall Street because it was a slave market. And this picture shows that this is how it would go on here in New York City at Wall Street. This is a letter from John Coles from the city of New York, a merchant. He certifies that a female child named Isabel was born on the 14th day of August, the last part of his Negro woman slave named Peggy, and he abandoned according to law, which means he was selling his child. And that will show New York, June 14, 1803. This is a picture of an enslaved man by the name of Caesar. And Caesar lived to be 115 years old. The thing about Caesar, which you will see later in one of the presentations, is that Caesar still remained a slave after emancipation. But he had a long life, and all of it was as an enslaved person.
Dr. Robbins, I'm so sorry to interrupt, but just to let you know, I don't think we're able to see the PowerPoint.
You can't see it?
No. So sorry. maybe we don't need to, because it sounds, the information is good, but letting you know.
Yeah, I have the pictures. I can send it later.
Oh, yes.
You know, send it to Brenda. I'm so sorry, because I see it. It's very clear on my screen.
Okay.
I don't know why it's not showing to you.
It's probably not worth it, but if you want to, if you're in Zoom and you can do share screen, you should see your PowerPoint as an option. And if you click right there, we should
Hold on a second.
It might be that only the host can share.
Let's see. Well, okay. Let me just go back. I'm just going to finish it verbally.
Okay.
And then if I can show the screen later, because I'm looking at everything. Everything's showing you here. Anyway, after slavery, of course, we went from slavery to poverty. And that was like the origins of welfare in New York State, and that started around 1840. To also prove, oh my God, I hope we can see the videos when it's time to show them, but we'll work on that. I might have to take an earlier break for that. But there's a pile of human bones that were found on 10th Avenue, and they was supposedly the remains of the Negro or African slaves. And of course, in defiance of slavery, there were lots of runaways, and a lot of these runaways We're in New York's Hudson Valley as well, so all over the entire state. And for your information, New York had the second highest number of states slaves in the entire enslaved in the entire country. And emancipation took place on July the 4th of 1827. Time emancipating New York, the politics of slavery. As I said, slavery existed in New York State from colonial times through the creation of the modern state, and Alexander Hamilton, John Jay, and other prominent New Yorkers owned slaves at one time. But the more reform-minded of these organizations to end slavery in New York, such as the New York Manumission Society. You can see the for sale sign of a healthy young Negro wench. She was between the ages of 15 and 16. Mm-hmm. She'd been used for farming. They wanted to sell her, and they're going to sell her on William Street in Manhattan. Mm-hmm. And that's New York, March 30th, 1789.
Mm-hmm. Oh,
as you know, Wall Street at this time is known as the financial capital of the world. We started the wealth there. Mm-hmm. Because they were selling the enslaved there at Wall Street. So if anybody tells you anything about New York and who owns it, say it's us. This was the letter from a gentleman in the city of New York. And he's certifying that a female child named Isabella was born on the 14th day of August to his Negro, to my Negro woman slave, okay? Because we were property, or was known as property, and they had a child named Peggy, and he's abandoning this child or selling this child according to the law. And that took place in, as you can see at the bottom here, New York, June 14th, 1803. This is Caesar. Caesar was enslaved in New York City. As forementioned, he lived to 115 years old, but he was never emancipated. And even though he lived after the emancipation of slavery in New York State. As we go from slavery into, I guess you could call it some sort of reconstruction, we went, the welfare system was created as a result of that. And these are a pile of human bones on 10th Avenue and Isham Street, and they are thought to be the remains of slave enslaved. And in defiance, a lot of the enslaved ran away all up and down the Hudson Valley, you know, which goes from lower state to upstate. So just to prove that we were all over New York State. Finally, emancipation took place on July 4th of 1827. And there's a long history of that. And that's the end of the show. Okay, so now, thank you. I want to know if you have any questions or comments about the PowerPoint presentation. Let me get off of this. Now, where are we? Zoom. Okay.
I have a question.
Yes. Who's speaking?
Oh, this is Marilyn.
Hi, Marilyn.
Hi, thank you so much. Although I wasn't able to see the images, I couldn't figure out how to do it. But I'm wondering, I know there was an abolition movement in New York, and I believe it was mixed race because, I know that there were African Americans who were active. Do you know anything about that? Like, how was it organized? Was it through churches? And how much participation was there on the part of the African American community, the so-called freedmen? Do you know?
I don't know, but maybe one of our historians knows. Maybe Dr. Seraille might know. Dr. Seraille?
Okay, is he on the call?
Yeah, could you open it back up? Is he still here? Is Dr. Seraille still on the phone?
I don't see him. Can you repeat the question again?
Yeah, ask the
question. I'm asking about the abolition movement in New York and what, how much participation was there in it on the part of the freed African Americans?
Oh, okay. The abolition movement itself. Yeah, oh, African American movement.
Yes, there was an active abolition movement in New York. I posted a little bit about it on the ASALH page. I'm so bad with names. There was a minister in Albany who gave a very famous speech the day after abolition.
Okay, yeah. Well, I think sometimes when we say abolition, some folks tend to think William Lloyd Garrison or white abolitionists, but for, right, you know, what in ASALH, when we say abolitionists, we obviously this includes black abolitionists. And
right,
and so African Americans in New York were very active in their own liberation, for sure. Frederick Douglass and,
right,
and Rochester and
right,
so many things. Yeah, so many of the things that Dr. Robin showed in her presentation. So to answer your question, yes, it was very interracial cooperation. There was definitely the case.
Any other questions or comments? Do you have any comments about it?
I would just like to say that there had, of course, there was a limit in terms of what African Americans could do. Most of them were enslaved, and many of them who were not enslaved were really in poverty. However, they were doing what they could, those who were enslaved and those who were not. Nobody wanted to remain slaves. When they could get in, there were runaways, you know, there were rebellions that right now I don't have the dates before me, but we need to read. There are books that can help us with this history. I think later on in the program, there'll be a recommendation of some books that you can get to answer some questions like that.
Okay. Any other questions or comments? Or if not, we can move on. Thank you, Mrs. Jackson. Well said.
Good afternoon. Hi, Reverend. Good afternoon.
And how are you doing?
I'm blessed to see the God family.
Happy holiday. Happy Abolition Day.
Yeah, happy holy days. Happy abolition of slavery in New York State. Blessings to Mother Bessie Jackson.
My
salute to all queens and kings online. Those historic facts that I've heard you all speak on are just stacked up to heaven from earth, whereas the backtrack and retrospect of some of the things that we can Google now can pinpoint the abolitionists that were of other ethnicities, as you have so wisely and richly shared, Mother Bessie Jackson, that the enslaved people of color, from Hebrews to Negroes, amen, have joined the ranks of those of other ethnicities, the pink people, the white abolitionists that they might call them, who were attacked by the radical Ku Klux Klan and were killed alongside of the Hebrew ancestors of ours. And, you know, those are just little briefs that we can share now, but thank God for technology and the movement of ministry where you can Google all the answers to those questions and get more basic details and more facts. But for the most part, the Lord has always, as Sister Bessie Jackson has said, been our guide to make the first last and the last first. He didn't put a period there. He put a comma there due to all of our ancestors' hypocrisies. So now we have the blending of these things coming to fruition. I think we're going towards the third renaissance now with the covert and the George Floyd thing, world-renowned and reputable. And I think that we are on a good place with the abolishment of slavery in New York State, our second celebration, our second Monday from 2019 to 2020, the spiritual vision. So, you know, those are just some of the briefs that I have to share with the God family. It's good to see y'all.
Yes,
I'm excited and delighted. I'm excited and delighted, Dr. Bessie, Dr. Gina. I see our sister Boles. I heard Pastor Paris' voice. I didn't see him.
He's next up on the program.
All right. And I heard a couple of the voices and all the teamwork that makes the dream work. But I've been praying. I ain't playing, y'all. I just came back from moving ministry across the state lines on the turnpike. And a lot of homegoings and funerals, but supporting folks and encouraging folks to, like Mother Bessie Jackson has just so richly told us in the onslaught, just keep on looking to the Lord because he is the master of miracles and he's continuing to be a mighty, mighty, mighty good leader.
Yes, thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you. So if there are no further questions or comments, you know, I want you to also make comments of something that might be on your heart or on your mind regarding anything that's been presented to you to speak up and say what you need to say. Okay, so right now we are moving on to a prayer by Reverend Reginald Paris of the United Christian Baptist Church.
Praise God, everybody. Praise God. I want to make sure y'all can hear me. Amen.
Amen. So
let's give some praise unto the Lord our God in our spaces where we sit. Amen.
Amen.
Surely he is worthy to be praised. I'm grateful to be part of this day. And I bring you greetings, of course, from United Christian Baptist Church, located at 713 East 22nd Street in the best borough, the best city, the best state in the world. Amen. Right. It is the best, in spite of what that's some right. may say. It that's is right. the best.
That's I agree. Right.
Praise God. Praise right. God. Let us pray. Most holy and heavenly Father God, God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, Father in heaven, creator of all things in heaven and in the earth. Yeah. You are perfect, O God, in all your ways, Lord. You have your will for your people. And beneath everything, Lord, beneath everything that we read about, beneath everything that we see, oh Lord, beneath everything that we hear, beneath, oh Lord, everything that's before us, beneath racism, oh God, beneath the protests, oh God, beneath the hatred, oh God, beneath even the pandemic, oh God, we know that you desire our every day, oh Lord, to be like a day in heaven. And so we ask you, Lord, today for you to reveal to us today your will. Reveal your will to us, oh Lord. Show us your will for our finances, for our lives, Lord, for our friendships, oh God, for our marriages, for our relationships, oh God, with one another, that we may be friend and not foe, that we may be friend and not enemy. Touch our children, oh God. Show us your will for our jobs, oh God, our very nation, this very country that we live in, oh God. We are grateful, oh Lord, for how you have redeemed us from the pit, oh God. We have made for ourselves. Thank you, Lord, for your mercy. Thank you, Lord, for your grace. Yeah. Thank you, Lord, for your love, Lord. Thank you for your son, Jesus the Christ, who died for our sins, oh God. Cause us to grow in love for him, Lord. Cause us, oh God, to be a light in this very dark time, God. Cause us, oh Lord, to grow in our knowledge of you and your words, oh God. Cause us, oh God, to be empowered. Empower us, Lord, to new levels of spiritual growth. Empower us, oh God, that we may develop one with another. Father, Lord, we for those who have yet to embrace you, Lord, for those who have yet to receive you, we ask you, Lord, by faith, that we pray for them right now, Lord. We pray that they also would turn from their sins and trust in you. We pray for our country. We pray for that man that's in charge, oh God. We pray that you touch him so he be awakened, Lord, to see the truth. Lord, trust in your son alone for salvation, oh God. And we pray that all worship you as their Lord and Savior. Most of all, Lord, we thank you. We thank you, oh God, for your grace and your mercy. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. And they all say, amen.
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 Amen. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Praise God.
Thank you. Let's give the Lord a hand clap, y'all.
All right, we're here.
Thank you, Reverend.
You're so very welcome. Thank you.
God bless you. And as always, we thank you for allowing us to have our in-person meetings at the church.
Amen.
I think we take anything for granted. Thank you so much. And say hello to your beautiful wife and your daughter and your grandson.
Will do. Amen.
Thank you. And stay with us if you can. Thank you.
Amen.
So as we move along, our next presenter or speaker will be Mrs. Madge Allen, the president of the Bronx, I mean the Manhattan branch.
The boogie down, motherland, mainland.
You have her?
Yeah.
Madge, you there?
Can you hear me?
I can hear you. There you go. Hi.
How's
everybody today?
All right.
We thank you all for the wonderful program and for Dena and also for Zebulon. He's doing a beautiful job. Even though we are not together in person, I feel very good about the program today. It's going very well. Okay. I will not comment on a lot of things.
Someone else is talking.
Okay. But thank all of you all for your participation. Okay, and as Bessie has already said, this is our second annual holiday, and we are looking forward to the one next year. And from then, we hope by then they will have passed the law for a national holiday. See something else that we there will be no. Please vote if. Everybody has received a ballot in the mail. It should be voted on by August the 7th. So please vote. That's for ASALH. All right. Okay, there's something else I would like to say too, is that 161st Street and Morris Avenue, That's on July the 15th, which is Wednesday. They will be painting it Black Lives Matter on that corner that day. So you all who would like to participate and give them support, please do so, okay? I think that's about it. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Any questions for Mrs. Allen?
And what's the time on 161st Mars? What time?
Two.
I beg your pardon?
7:00 is two. Finally, in this era of the coronavirus, how long is it?
Let me get that time. I get it.
Thank you.
Okay. Carol Brown.
It's 10 a.m. Yeah, 10.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, and that's 161st and Morris Avenue.
Right. 161st.
Right over there by the courthouse.
Right.
Right, okay.
So much.
Thank you so very much.
Okay, Zebulon.
Yes.
The next thing on the schedule is a video, an 8-minute video. Now, how could I get that up?
Okay, we can do this. What you need to do is find the video first outside of Zoom. Come out of Zoom and just double click on that video that you want to show.
Okay, hold on. Cannot minimize Zoom, but I gotta go to the video.
Yep.
Let's see.
If it's on the desktop, just go to your desktop and double click it.
Oh, I see. I know where I did it last time. I can't minimize Zoom. Hold a second. This is what I'm going to do. Y'all hold tight. Let me pause the recording. See if I can minimize now. I still can't. Nope.
Okay, but if it opened up,
let me see.
Then come back to Zoom. And then do the share.
161 in Morris.
164.
And then you share screen on the bottom.
Let me go to desktop. See if I can get the desktop on this thing.
Okay,
1 second. Desktop. The name of this one is New York City Slave Market.
So if you open.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
1 second.
All right.
Okay, hold on. I have it. Now what to do?
Okay, now are you back in Zoom? Can you see all of us again?
Hold a second.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, then on the bottom, you see it says share screen, the green arrow.
Yeah.
Click on that.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. And then you should see one of the options should be your video.
Yeah.
Okay.
There we go.
Is that it?
You see it?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah. Did you double click?
See it?
Yeah. You're seeing your desktop now.
You see it?
Yes, this is your desktop.
It's just the desktop.
You don't hear the movie?
Uh-uh.
No.
No.
Let me start you over. Okay, I'm gonna unshare.
Wait.
Okay, then, but this time when you click share screen, find the option
hold
that has the video. Mm-hmm.
Say that again.
Your video player, that's what you wanna share.
I wanna share the video player.
Yeah, whatever program plays those videos on your desktop, on your computer, I mean.
Okay, hold a second. That's music.
Did you click share screen again?
Yeah, but let me see. I don't know where it went again.
Okay. Is this something you can send me that I can maybe bring up? Is this something you want to send me that I can try to show?
Hold a second.
Okay.
Give me your address.
Okay, I'm just going to type it into the, it's just my last name, Maletsky at gmail.com.
Okay. Hold on.
Maybe we can switch the schedule around and come back to that.
Hi, Brenda.
Hi.
I'm trying, everybody.
I'm okay.
Accept my apologies, please.
You're doing good.
Don't worry, Brenda. Give me a lesson. They taught me 2 days ago how to do it.
All of this, huh?
Yeah, so I have to just teach you.
Okay. Teach me. I am teachable.
Okay.
So let's see. What is this? And that's the Zoom. Wait. That's that. I don't think I need that. Y'all still there?
Yeah.
Okay. What's this? No. I'll tell you what, let's move forward, but then I really need to show this thing. Wow. Okay, Zebulon, y'all give me this 2 minutes. Let me understand this. Where am I going? I have everything right here on the desktop, but I forgot that I didn't do it the way my son told me to. That's why you need kids and grandkids so they can do this for you.
When you went to the desktop, we all saw that file. If you just double click on it on your own, then yeah. When you go to share your screen, it's available to you. If you opened it, you had already opened it up. Mm-hmm.
I did, but where'd it go? That's the problem.
Yeah, take your time. When you click share screen, you got a lot of options. Make sure to find, you'll see it. If you take your time, you'll see the video.
Okay, this was the PowerPoint. I'm gonna close that out because we did that already. Mm-hmm. Now, let me go.
Yeah, just take your time.
That's AOL, this is Word. I don't want Word.
A PC, a video like that probably would be Windows Media Player, I think.
Mm-hmm.
That's what you want to share. That's what you want to
share. Okay, hold on. I have everything sitting right there. My son told me what to do, but I guess I didn't follow instructions right.
Is he there?
No.
This young man, right away.
No. If he was, I'd be better off. But he's not here. That's what another birthday will do for you, right?
It's a blessing to grow old.
Amen. I'm getting there.
Yeah, we I'll tell you. Keep going. We're trying to keep up.
Amen.
Yes.
Okay, here's the media player.
Hey, that sounds promising. Yeah, try sharing screen again. This.
Meantime,
do you want to skip the agenda?
Yeah, let's go on to Dr. Seraille. Is he here? Mm-hmm. Is Dr. Seraille on the line?
Back.
Dr. Seraille? Is Dr. Seraille here? Dr. Seraille or Reverend Stewart?
Okay, oh, I see, because there's Q&A about the video itself. All right. We lost Dr. Seraille, I think. I definitely saw him on in the beginning.
He's not there?
Yeah, I don't think so. I don't
know why. Okay, so is Reverend Stewart there? Reverend Deborah Stewart? So she's not on the line. So this is what we're going to do.
Let me make
sure we're going to take a
muted.
15-minute break then.
Deborah Stewart's on the line. Hold on.
Oh, she is?
Yeah, she sure is. Hold on a sec.
Okay.
Sorry. Okay.
Okay, now I'm here. You have me muted.
I can hear her well.
Oh, sorry.
Good morning. All right. Good afternoon. I'm
good
sorry.
Afternoon.
Reverend Hand is trying to get online, so if you're getting another call, he's trying to get in.
Okay, I just let him in. Okay.
Thank you.
Thank
good
you.
Morning. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Okay. All right, I don't have the program in front of me. I'm going to try to get it again. What am I doing? Hello?
Program.
Excuse me?
Yep. Okay. So
I don't see the... Oh, okay.
Here we are.
Okay.
Now, where am I?
Okay, I'll tell them just a minute. Yeah.
You're on my list. You're on my list.
Yeah. Excuse me.
Yes.
Dr. Seraille is on the line. He said he can hear, but you know he can't get a response through. Yeah.
Okay.
Star six.
What phone number is he? Does he? Do you know?
They want your phone number. Dr. Seraille.
I should have it.
347-224.
Got it. Okay.
Yeah. Excuse me, say that again.
He got it.
Sorry. Yes, thank you.
474-0099.
Okay, he is.
Okay, did you get it?
Yes, ma'am. He is. He should be able to talk now.
He said you should be able to talk now. I guess you can hang up there.
I don't have him as being muted. He's not muted.
Is he on mute?
Oh, no. I'll mute the phone, okay? Yeah. Hold a minute. Dr. Seraille wants to know what to do.
Can he speak?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. Well, I'm listening to you on the phone, so.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, can you hear him?
I'm going to bring him on now. Trying to bring him on.
They're working on bringing you on.
You can't be on both at the
Well, it's just me now. Yeah. How do you?
I will unmute everybody.
I see Dr. Seraille.
Is he back? We have him?
Yes. He's right there.
Oh, great. Okay, let me stop the sharing. There we go.
Tell me when to have him.
Okay. All right, Dr. Seraille, can you hear us?
Do you need to
No, he doesn't hear you. He keeps saying hello.
Wait, you on the telephone.
Is his phone muted? Because on this end, you're unmuted.
Oh, is your phone muted?
She can't talk to both at the same time.
Then it's not. He hasn't muted his phone because he doesn't know how to.
Okay, I see. He's calling through the phone.
Yeah, just a moment, Dr. Seraille.
Gotta hang up.
Should I hang up?
Yeah.
Huh?
Yes.
Yes.
He's muted though. I don't understand.
If I hang up, I'm cutting Dr. Seraille off.
But you need to.
I need to cut him off?
That's the problem.
Okay. Cut him off.
Let him go, please.
I'm hanging up, okay? All right, okay. All right.
Dr. Seraille, can you hear us?
He got to die, you know.
See, I just cut him off, so maybe I should have muted it instead of.
Is he, okay, I think what's going on is he's on the phone and a computer or a separate device at the same time. Mm-hmm. So.
What's the phone now? I hung up.
You got to zoom back in on this line.
Yeah, we have video. We can see you, but we don't have audio. Trying to think what we can do to get you with audio. Let me see if I can. I'll just call him. We can hear 3-8-4-7-2-2-4. Okay, that's his phone. I see he's on his cell phone. He's on his iPhone.
I don't see him on my screen.
Merge with audio. Okay. Are you on two devices? Is that your number 917? Dr. Seraille, or is that someone else? Who is 917-270?
No, that's my number.
Okay, roger that. I'm gonna call him.
In the meantime, I did get that video back.
Hello?
Oh, was that him?
Yes, him.
Yay.
That's him.
Oh, okay, hello? Doctor. Yes, we hear you.
You hear me now?
Yes, sir.
Yes. Hi, Dr. Seraille.
Fine. But now I can't see anybody. But
right, while we're ahead.
Okay, a couple of things. We were asking about African-American participation. When you go to the library, there's a book, Documentary History of the Negro People in the United States. It's edited by Herbert Apthecker, Apthecker. It's a multi-volume documentary series. You do have a number of examples of African Americans in the 18th century, like petitions, sermons, and so forth, dealing with the abolitionist movement. And also, after slavery ends in New York, you had a committee called the Vigilance Committee that started in 1837. And what they're doing is to stop people from being kidnapped, because a lot of people lived down the lower portion of Manhattan, down the area around the courthouses, below like 14th Street, and it was near the waterfront, the docks. So the vigilance committee would go out at nighttime to make sure people weren't pick up from bars or off the streets, and then put it on ships and send further south. So definitely you had the kind of interracial cooperation. You still hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Yep. Then I have some suggestions. One is 2027 would be 200 years of emancipation in New York State. And if we don't have a state holiday by that time, now it's time to get started with publicity.
Right.
Josh Barker worked for the Amsterdam News, and he I guess he's a member because he has participated in a number of our programs.
Yes.
And I think that he could do something for the Amsterdam News, but also Josh works with Gary Bird on WBAII, and I think he could maybe set up some interviews with Gary and some of us to talk about New York State and emancipation. Also, Gloria Brown Marshall has a program on WBAI on Tuesday mornings at 9 o'clock. And once before, she had a program, Bessie was on and I was on, discussing ASALH. So I think if we contact her, we might be able to get her to devote a portion of her program, again, interviewing some of us to talk about New York State emancipation. And I think we need to, like in New York One, same thing, try to get an interview to talk about it. Because it's a thing that takes time. It took a long time to get the Dr. King holiday, but people were having observations of that long before it got a groundswell for a national holiday. And the same with Juneteenth. That took a long time too. I mean, that was just localized in Texas, and now it's all over the country. So it's a question of being diligent and patient and working with other people to make sure this comes forth. So those are mainly my comments. Sometimes we want things, we can't get them right away, but we organize and we plan, and then we can get assistance from others, and I think we can get it. You have any questions, maybe?
I think you have some great suggestions, Dr. Seraille, in terms of how to move forward with this issue.
Yeah, because again, I mean, people like to celebrate, you know, like 100 years or 200 years celebrations, and the mm-hmm. fact that 2027 is only 6 years away,
yeah.
that it may be time to start working on that now. Mm-hmm. Hopefully we'll have a holiday before,
yeah.
Because we know politicians respond to pressure, and they like to be on the winning side. Mm-hmm. Otherwise they use every tendency to ignore things. So I think we can start that and get our allies, particularly those in the media. I mean, someone like Brian Benjamin, I'm not sure when the next election would be for his office, but he has been supportive. And if someone could interview him, again, over one of the radio programs, it would be helpful.
Can you spell his last name for me, please?
Brian Benjamin. Like the name Benjamin.
Oh, I know Brian.
Yeah, he's a state senator representing right, the Harlem area.
I know. I got you. Thank you. Oh, my name is Wilson.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank I don't know so how come much. I lost the video. I had the visual, but then I couldn't speak, and now I can't hear and I can't see, so. Yeah. I probably have to go back into Zoom and see if I can find
okay,
that
well,
again.
But. Join again. But thank you so much. Zebulon, yeah. You there? Thank you so much, Dr. Seraille. Zebulon, you there?
Yes, ma'am. Yeah.
Are there any other questions?
The video. I can do
any
it.
Other questions?
Good.
So what do I have to do?
Any other questions for Dr. Seraille?
Any other questions?
Oh, sorry, Dr. Seraille.
I was asking any more questions.
I don't think so, Doc. And I don't. Okay,
I just want to repeat. I want to repeat that book, Herbert Aptheker, E P E T H E K E R, a documentary history of the Negro people in the United States. There's multi volumes, about 7 or 8 volumes, but the first volume, you do have like these petitions in the latter part of the 1700s. Around the country, but also in terms of New York, because you did have clergymen who would have sermons and petitions trying to get support from the state legislature. And then the certainly with the Manumission Society, again, you had African-American involvement. So next time you're able to go to a library like the Schoenberg, you can look up the documentary history of the Negro people in the United States, Volume 1. Okay, all right. I'll see
Thank
if I can get
so
back
much.
To the back to the visuals.
Stand by, Dr. Seraille, because I finally got this video up, and I think you might have.
Yeah, I'm coming back. I'm coming back.
Okay. Okay. All right. All right, so Zebulon, could everybody hold tight? Because I got this video right now. How do I get it up?
Prayer. I think we're gonna have to pray on this. This is
share
a good
screen
group,
and then
a
hit
good
it.
Group for this. Oh yeah, sorry.
Or hit it
share,
and share
screen.
Screen.
Yeah.
Share screen. And then hit it. Got it?
Oh, I don't see anything.
Can you see it?
Are you sure you shared screen? I don't see that. I didn't see that happen.
Okay, I thought I did. Hold on.
Yeah, try one more. I know this is going to get it this time. I know
Hold
it.
Hold on. Hold on. Hold on. Share screen. Boom. Right?
You clicked on share screen.
Yeah.
And now the
and I'm going to my desktop. Then I'm gonna do this. Got it.
And what you do hit now?
only thing.
I don't have.
Is it playing on your screen now?
Yeah.
Okay, the only thing is for, see now when the way you're doing it, it's not gonna open for
wait
us.
Wait a minute, wait.
All right.
It's not playing on your screen?
No.
Oh.
I'm dealing with one crisis.
Wait a minute.
Hey, just come back for a minute.
I'm a Bible group.
It worked so well last time. You can hear it though, right?
Mm-hmm. No,
I really
can't see it.
Now the trick is, you got it right, but when you click on share screen, instead of clicking to the desktop, to the file where you can see the name of the file, you got to click on to Windows Media Player, that window, and then that one. Okay.
Okay. See, okay. Okay. Let me do it one more time.
Try that. Please.
Okay. Hold up. Hold up. Okay, so now we're gonna try one more time.
Oh, okay.
Oh, technology.
You're gonna get it this time, I know it.
Okay, this one is.
Are you kidding?
What's the screen share? Oh, share screen.
Get the thing up there. I'm gonna get off.
Oh boy.
Now it disappeared. It won't do it that way. It won't do it that way.
Somebody not teaching me because I'd be all over.
Okay, we're gonna take a break. Let's take a break. And
I
I'll work with Zebulon as you're all taking a break. Okay.
I'll try to start a video that might be like the one that you show.
Okay, listen.
I don't know if it'll
why
be
don't we,
good.
We have a 15-minute break now. Oh no, Reverend Stewart's supposed to pray.
Okay.
Right. Reverend Stu is supposed to pray on my list here.
Amen.
So let her pray, and then we take the 15-minute break, and I'll find the video, okay?
Gracious Father, we just truly thank you for this day which you have made. Lord, forgive us for anything that we've done wrong, thought wrong, said wrong. God, forgive those who have done us wrong. Mm-hmm. Oh, God, bless this organization. Bless the purpose, God. Bless the leaders. Bless those who are diligently teaching, God. We thank you for wisdom. God, we thank you for our leaders. We thank you for our forefathers and foremothers. Lord, bless this unit that it can go forth, even as Black Lives Matter. Let them be knowledgeable about abolition and slavery. God, thank you for those who come together. Lord, you created all of us, and we thank you. And God, bring us back to this meeting on one accord, and we thank you for having agendas. Thank you for the giver of life. Thank you for your son, Jesus Christ. And everybody say amen, amen, and amen.
Amen. Thank you, Reverend Deborah Stewart. Right now, the time is 1:30. We'll come back together at 1:40. 10 minutes.
Okay.
Okay. And in the
can
meantime.
Can you post that book again, please? Because I didn't get all the information.
Okay.
We're coming back.
Zebulon, you and I are going to work on getting this video up while everybody else is taking a break, okay?
Okay, yeah. Rev Stewart, this is in the chat. I put it in the chat there.
Believe it or not, I'm not savvy with Zoom. This is my third time.
Too. Oh, no problem.
Okay. Oh, mine what? Too, Reverend.
Okay, it's
my
Herbert.
Third time. That's why I don't know diddly. And I'm trying.
All right.
I've invited Reverend Alan Hand. He's on. I invited him.
God bless y'all.
God bless you too.
Bless you.
And I'm Reverend Tyne's cousin.
Oh, okay. All in the family.
And I'm praise and worship leader at Convent Avenue Baptist Church in Harlem. Reverend Jesse T. Williams.
Amen.
Pastor.
Amen.
Thank
okay.
You.
So, Zebulon, it's you and I. Come on, help me out.
Okay, no break for me. I said,
no break
on.
For you or me.
I'm right with you. I'm right here with you.
Okay, so
can
now.
Can you post that book again? I just wanted to get that.
Because
it came book? On and it went off fast.
Let me bring it up. I'll show you. Let me see if I can bring it up in a text format.
Okay, hit the camera. Go.
Like that.
Cover the camera.
It's Herbert, yeah, it's the book that Dr. Seraille mentioned is Herbert Apfecker.
Okay, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to take a picture of it with my cell phone. Thank you.
You know, it works too. I don't have a picture.
I got it.
Okay,
got it.
All right, Stuart, then. We got to keep
you.
Moving.
Right, Deborah,
everybody
send me
take a break,
picture.
Please, so we can all get right. This right for the second half, please. Thank you.
All right. Break. God bless. Thank you.
God bless. All right. Take a break.
I'm afraid right, if I Zeb. Get off, I won't get back on now.
Yes, don't go leave, but just don't leave. Thank you for being here.
Okay, I'm okay.
Don't leave. Okay, Zeb.
Yeah. Okay. So the trick is with Zoom is that it shares whatever, it doesn't share a document, but it shares whatever application that document may open. So if you had a PowerPoint, when you double clicked on your PowerPoint, when you went to share, you see PowerPoint as one of the options.
Right, it
so, works. So what we need to do is double click on that video and then whatever application that opens it, which is probably Windows.
Okay, let me find it again. Because it's not in any of these videos that I have.
Yeah, I think the trick is really taking your time. Once you start sharing, it brings up that little box. And you got like four or five different things to choose from. It could be tricky to see which one is the right one. So just really take your time. Yeah, that's just take your time when you look at it. Just
okay. Hold on, I'm gonna minimize this here. Oh, I cannot minimize Zoom.
Is it something on YouTube, maybe?
Yeah, it is there.
Okay.
But I saved it to my desktop. My desktop. Where's my desktop?
Have you, did you double click on the, on that video?
No. My desktop file folder.
Let me show you something, Dr. Robbins. I'm going to share this, my screen. Show me if one of these videos might be, I have a lot of windows open, so, but, are you able to see this list? This is just, I just did a search.
No, I don't see your list.
Okay. Top 10 secrets of NYC.
Yeah, I see that, yeah.
Uh-oh.
Okay, so this one, the next one.
This one?
Yeah, that's the one I'm trying to show.
The one. Oh, okay. Let's do a test run. Just make sure it's the right one.
See, because it keeps buffering sometimes, you know?
Mm-hmm. I know. If I had known, I'd have got in touch with you a little more in advance. That's on me. I wish I had reached out to you.
Right there. That's one.
That's the one you want? Okay. Got it. Yeah. I'll keep it queued up.
That's one of them. Okay. Let me give you the next one. It's on that same thing. Let's keep going down these things here.
All right. Okay. I got
not
you.
That one. Not that 19-minute one. We're not going there. Okay. So the next one would be the untold story of slavery.
I see it. All right.
The untold.
Yes, Kay. I'm doing okay, and you? I'm still, we went on, what time did I go over, like we supposed
right
to
be celebrating? There. That's it.
All right.
That's the second one.
7:45, supposed to end up at 2.
Now, the third one still, is called.
Them. Yeah, that's me not talking. I was going to do something I wasn't going to go down. Uh-huh. So, but I will when I go
down. Seneca.
Then
Seneca I'm, Village.
If I didn't have a job in just
Seneca Village.
I don't know.
He's so busy talking on the phone. They're trying to find some, somebody that was having a concert.
Like, you know, and
Daddy.
Oh, that's the first one, right?
I know how she feels, because she
Seneca Village is the last one.
Is this one here?
Yes.
All right. We are good to go then.
I did the research. I put it on the whatever. I just didn't know how to. My son told me something. I guess I must have got it twisted.
Oh, I tell you, you need two people to do these things. Really?
Yeah.
When you're the host and you're trying to do all the technical, it's a little
okay,
too much.
Mm-hmm. Now, yeah, it's too much for me. Thank you, right. Zebula.
You're welcome. I'm going to bring up the agenda while we're waiting, and then the
okay, wait.
Oh.
There's one more thing.
Oh, okay.
And that's Reverend Dr. William L. Watkins Jr. Look at, he's on the web.
Okay. Excuse me. You're not seeing this. That's all right.
You don't see him?
Show me, let me know if any of these are what we're looking for. Is it a video as well?
Okay, so.
Hold on.
There's something by his granddaughter.
Is it a video as well? Not necessarily.
Yeah, try this. Wait a minute. Try that. For, yeah.
Yeah, that looks.
Okay, so what are you all planning to do then?
No, that's not the one.
Change your lock.
Yeah, okay. Go ahead up. You could just put his picture there.
Oh, I see what you're saying. You will. Yeah.
But that's not it.
Hold on, let me try YouTube again.
Yes, yes. I think that's where it is.
Usually everything is.
Yeah.
All roads lead to YouTube. What? Anything here?
Okay, there's... No, it was very short.
Something about his daughter?
His granddaughter.
I thought, okay then.
Something old, is it this?
It's brand new because it just passed.
Okay.
Let's put his name in.
Jill, I remember. I remember Jill was saying something. Wait, Kay, just listen. I know you're upset, but let's listen. Let's stop screaming. Okay, Kay. Because Jill was saying, stop fussing.
Right, go back one page. Go back.
You something.
Just roll up.
Okay. And I'm sorry that it's getting to that point. But I want to
roll it up.
Oh,
go to this one. Yeah, right there. Click on that.
Leave her alone. Unless she spoke to me.
We can go with that. But that's not what I wanted to be seen.
I'm not.
Something by his granddaughter.
I'm not talking about. So what I'm trying to do.
If I can keep finding that.
I see that. See, you don't know. Hey. Okay, hey.
He's a doctor, too.
Have I lied to you about anything else?
Okay, we got to go back on. No. There it is. Right there. That's it.
Hi.
No. When you
right
say
there. Copy. Right okay. there. Yep.
Cool. Good. That's nice.
Name. So this and that. I'm yeah. Go. Okay. We're gonna hit it head on.
Just saying.
Right. Okay.
Okay.
Okay. We're ready.
I want the job to change.
Let's say, is it over yet?
I think got a couple more minutes. I believe.
Okay. Maybe
one more minute.
Got a little
bit. You said 45. You said 145.
Yeah. I said 40, but
five.
We give it 5 minutes.
Okay.
Zebulon, you are godsend.
Oh, I'm glad to help. I believe in this cause very much.
Yes, I see. You are a godsend. I remember seeing you on that last thing. Mm-hmm. That's why I recognized you, the last Zoom.
Oh, all right.
And I clouded off. I said, I'm not going to be seen today. My hair was looking crazy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, we in New York, we have to come together in a while. Very important.
Mm-hmm. All right, so how we're going to proceed is that we're going to do the memorial first, and then we'll do the video, two of the videos. Because that's 11 minutes, one of them. Let me see. One is Wall Street. That's really 7. And the Untold Story of Slavery is 5. That's 12 minutes. Well, all I can tell you is I'm good at organizing. I don't know about the other part.
Oh, you've done great. And that PowerPoint looked really good.
Thank you.
Yeah, Risa, how you doing? Risa, I know I told the people we still on a conference call, not a conference, Zoom, where we usually have that.
All in Madge business.
So we've
been this thing is amazing.
Let me mute
that. Laptop from 11:45.
Now I'll have to, I could organize it, you know, the way I had it organized was good, but the what do you call it? Implementation was horrible for me. Thank God for you. I'd have been off this call because I wouldn't have been able to do it. I thought I did it the way my son told me to do it, but I didn't. He said I should set up a folder with all, with the MP4s in it, and then just go to that folder and click on, but it's not that easy.
Sometimes it takes a few songs. Don't worry about it. We just,
yeah,
we're brothers. We're working on it.
All right.
I have a question for Brother Zebulon.
Reverend. Hi.
Yeah.
Is there any way to do Facebook with Facebook and Zoom the same time, simultaneously?
To go live to Facebook? Yeah, there is a way to do that. But I don't know whose account this one is on.
No, I'm not asking for that. That's just something I was asking Reverend Hand, did he know? And he said he didn't know, so I said, well, you seem very technical, savvy.
But you can't, no, you sure can. You can, because you see people on Facebook with Zoom.
Facebook Live, because they invite people, right?
Yeah, Facebook Live, I know.
Yeah.
It comes down to the settings for this account, whoever's account this is. Dr. Robin, this is your account? Okay.
Yes.
There's a.
I don't want to do this on Facebook. This is just for my own personal use.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Facebook's nice to reach others since this is a celebration.
It would have been nice for us to do that. It would have.
Well, what I can tell you is, some of you may know, I deal with the, you know, what we're calling ASALH TV now, and I'm the chair of the marketing and PR committee, so we will air this. Oh, I'll edit it, though.
I hope so, because you don't want them to see how many mistakes I made.
Okay, when they see this, it's going to be so smooth. No one will even know about those mistakes. So maybe it's better we did not do Facebook Live.
And okay, I have a cousin that works for the Daily News.
Everybody to come back. The break is over.
Yeah. I'm back.
Holiday. Let's give a shout out for the holiday. Yeah. Holiday.
All right.
Yes.
Free at last. Thank God Almighty. We are free at last. Love it.
Also, I was saying, I have a cousin that works for the Daily News.
Yes.
So if you need other media.
Thank you. We appreciate you. That. Yes. We'll be in touch Rev, with I would you love, for sure.
Yes, I would love to follow up with you, Rev. Thank you.
Okay, is everybody back? Come on back.
You said the New York 15 minutes, or?
You got a Zoom full of empty chairs here.
Tried to get away, but I couldn't. Hey, Miss Jackson.
Hi, Bonita.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Hey, Brenna. What's up? Evangeline.
Huh? Yeah.
Gang's coming back.
I'm just Ernest, grateful to my cousin, up? Gwen. I'm just you grateful good? To Dr. Reverend Times for inviting me.
Yes.
Yeah.
Let's see how many people came back after the break.
Is she waving?
Look like we're all back.
Everybody's back?
Yeah.
No, I don't think so. Did you have more boxes on the screen? How come Zebulon left Facebook?
I see, on a person I don't see his job, I thought I saw him a little while ago. So.
Zebulon?
Yep, I'm
He's
here.
Frozen on my screen.
I'm here.
We only have two on the screen.
Renaud? Okay. Zeb, give him a break. He didn't get no break. So at least we're all back.
I can give you my number and my email.
Okay, he started sharing. Okay, here's Zeb. So we're going down past the break. So we're going to start with Evangeline. Which I on my paper I spelled right, not this one. But sorry about that. Okay. Are you ready?
I got knocked off. I'm trying. I don't see any pictures. I'm trying to get back on.
Yeah, you're on. I see you.
We see you. We hear you.
I don't see anybody. I just see Zoom.
Yeah, we see you.
No, I don't see anybody.
I see you. You got on black and white with your glasses.
Yeah.
Right, well, like says,
on the bottom, you may see the Zoom icon if you click back on that.
I'm here.
The bottom?
Yeah.
No, I don't see it. I don't see anybody.
We see you.
Yeah.
You could try Alt
Trust
tab
that we,
on your
we
keyboard.
See you.
Okay.
Wait, what? Try what?
If you try the Alt button and the Tab button on your keyboard at the same Alt time.
The Alt button. Oh, what? The Alt button.
Yeah, hold down the Alt button and press Tab.
And press Tab. Okay. Oh, okay. Wait.
Fixed it. All
right. It went right back. That's how magic.
They'll see you.
Well, we can see you. Yep. It's like TV.
I can see you. All right. Let me see. Can I get back?
Try that Alt tab one more time.
It's got Zoom.
Not happening?
Nothing is happening.
Okay. Well, my understanding is you're going to sing today.
Who?
No.
Who singing?
Oh, it's the prayer.
No.
Oh, I'm sorry. Okay, but we can hear a prayer at this time.
Yes, we're going to do a prayer.
It just all messed up.
Don't worry, we can see you. Just pray.
But I want to see you. But I want to see you. Okay. Well, I'll just say something. Okay. I must say this has been a very humbling experience. And as surprised as I am that I'm going to pray, I will do my best. When I think about all that what our people went through, it makes me really appreciate my heritage better. And I must say that I'm just so grateful to be a part of a seller. Now that I understand it better, which I did not before, but I understand it better now. And it makes me really want to go on and learn. And I pray that we all learn how to be computer savvy. And I'm thankful for Dena being able to put this program together. And Ms. Jackson gave me some books to read that are just so wonderful, and I can understand everything better now. And I pray that we continue with the for Sarah, and we continue to grow strong, and we're able to get more members. In Jesus Christ, I pray. Amen.
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 Amen. Let's give God a hand clap, y'all.
All right.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Evangeline. That was beautiful. Even though you couldn't see us, we saw and heard you. Amen. Can you see us now?
No. Let me see. Can I get?
All right, so we're going to proceed. There's plenty of things that we have to complete on this, but I want to ask Zebulon to please put up the tribute to Reverend Dr. William L. Watkins, Jr.
Put him back, man.
Okay, put good.
Come back, man.
Amen.
My name is Dr. Leninia Elizabeth Montcomier, and I'm the granddaughter of Reverend Dr. William L. Watkins.
I can't see it.
Sorry. Sorry. First week of April,
and we're all still grieving.
Let me start it over.
My name is Dr. Leninia Elizabeth Montcomier, and I'm the granddaughter of Reverend Dr.
Can't understand her.
As many of you know, Grandpa passed away this first week of April. And we're all still grieving. As me.
Somehow we lost the volume.
I'm sorry, were you all unable to hear that? Are you able to hear?
I can't hear.
Can others hear?
No.
Okay. Oh, I didn't know that. Excuse me. Let me start that over.
Okay.
This should work this time.
My name is Dr. Leninia Elizabeth Montcomier, and I'm the granddaughter of Reverend Dr. William L. Watkins, Jr. As many of you know, Grandpa passed away.
How about now? Can you hear?
April, and we're all still. As many of you.
Hello.
Your loved ones. It's just so hard to grieve at a distance. We're not created for social distancing. God created us to gather and to celebrate the life.
How about now?
So I leave you these words of comfort as Grandpa would. 1 Corinthians 15:51. Behold,
just barely
a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trump shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. Verse 58. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. For as much as ye know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. His grandpa's labor was not in vain. It was certainly in the Lord. Until we see each other in person, God bless and be safe.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Yes.
Can you hear me?
Yeah,
I can hear you.
Yeah, I said that was his granddaughter, and she was given words of comfort that the trump shall resound. And how about in terms of her grandfather and everyone who believes? Okay, so we're going to move on now to the first video, which is New York City Slave Market, Wall Street. Okay, Zeb? Zebulon?
Yep.
Okay.
Can you see it?
Yeah.
All right.
Yo, guys, we're back again today, and today we're going to be learning about slavery in a slave market that was actually in the North. Everybody is used to hearing about it in the South, but we're going to talk about this occasion and event and occurrence or occurrences in the North. So let's get right into it. The New York slave market was located in what is now Wall Street and Pearl Street. Slave labor was supplied due to New York City growing at a rapid pace in 1711. New York City was also the biggest slave-owning place in the North. Many white American households had slaves in their homes, and these slaves did house duties such as cook, sew, and watch the children. These slaves would also do outdoor duties as well, such as building ships, harvesting, and planting crops in uptown. The African slaves would also bring goods and supplies back and forth to their masters and also supply steaming hot corn and fresh oysters, which is considered the city's first fast foods. As time went along, more and more slaves were being brought into the city or New York City. Many white Americans of different occupations would purchase these slaves and taught the slaves these trades. When the owner of the slave would run out of work, he would rent out the slave for half or a half discounted price to someone else to use for a certain amount of time. So many African descent peoples walking around the city now, it made whites in the city very nervous, and the thoughts of a slave uprising was very present. So the citizens started to complain and demand that a market where slaves could be sold, bought, and hired be established. Soon after, a law was passed by the city council that all Negro and Indian slaves that are let out to be hired at the market house at the Wall Street slave. Also in earlier years, in 1702, a law was passed to prohibit slaves from gathering in groups of three or more. This was the city's first slave market and is also known as the mill market because grain was also sold there as well. The mill market was one of the most profitable slave markets in the U.S., and Pier 17, or known today as South Street Seaport, was where the slaves would arrive. Slaves also contributed a lot to the city's earlier construction, including the wall in which Wall Street got its name from. This wall was originally directed to be built by Dutch Governor William Kieft to protect against Native American raids against white settlers in the 1600s. The governor tried to tax the Native Americans first, and when that did not work, he tried to drive them out. This led to the raids. Though the market was made for the purpose of stopping slave rebellions, these rebellions still occurred nonetheless. In 1712, just a year later, 24 African slaves rebelled at the East River and started setting fires. This plan was to lure people out of their homes into a trap and then ambush them. Though this worked, within the next couple of days, they were captured in a nearby woods. None of the slaves received legal counsel, Some were hanged, some killed themselves, and others were convicted. Another rebellion also took place in 1741, which is still unclear who started it. And this time, 10 fires were set off across Manhattan. Many of the citizens blamed the slaves and accused them for this. Soon after, slaves were burned at the stake, hanged, and some were shipped to the Caribbean, which was a very, very harsh punishment, seeing how slavery was in the Caribbean. Very, very harsh life. Some people actually looked at it in the same way as they did death. Around the 1760s, the mill market went into the renovation and became a very popular spot for the merchant coffee house. Though the merchants felt that the slave market was a sore eye in the area and wanted to remove it, these merchants were of the aristocratic class or upper class and did not want new prospects or more reputable coffee industry people that were joining to have to travel through this and see this. So in 1762, the Common Council drafted a petition stating that the mill market or the slave market was a dirty street and that it was offensive to the people who lived in the area and passed through. By February of that year, the mill market was torn down, though slaves were still sold and bought throughout the city. We also must note that the New York Stock Exchange was created down the street from the slave market. This exchange came from the Buttonwood Agreement. 24 brokers signed the Buttonwood Agreement to regulate trading securities and standardize commission compensation. This agreement was signed on May 17, 1792 at 68 Wall Street under a sycamore tree, also known as a buttonwood tree. Though the mill market had already been destroyed by this time of creation or its time of creation, the Buttonwood Agreement dealt with many financial issues surrounding the slave trade. In 1991, 400 Africans from the colonial era were uncovered during an excavation in Lower Manhattan. With the construction delayed, archaeologists uncovered 15,000 or more African Americans that were buried here during the 16 and 1700s. This is the largest colonial cemetery of Africans in the North Americas. We also learned how people of African descent were treated up north at the time in New York City, and that there was actually slaves in the North and a slave market in the North, contrary to a lot of people's belief that it was only down South. So as always, guys, add me on Instagram, Snapchat, Twitter, Facebook, All Afric Network. And until next time, always teach each other, learn from each other, listen to each other, stick together. And I will see you guys next time. So until next time, yo, peace. One love.
What's up, what's up?
Hey.
Shalom.
What up?
Hi.
Questions or comments about the video? New York City Slave Market, Wall Street.
Interesting.
I can't hear you. I can't hear anything.
Oh, hold up. Unmute. Sorry. That's my fault. Okay.
Okay. So, as I was saying, we've just seen New York City slave.
You couldn't say anything because the host didn't allow us to unmute ourselves.
Yeah, it was that was during the video.
Right.
My apologies. Okay, we good now? Okay, thank you.
Right. Okay. Comment?
I think if nobody else want to say anything, I think
hello?
That,
hello?
Yeah. I said, if nobody else want to say anything, I'm going to say something. Because
I can't see you.
I'm sitting too low.
I'm sorry. Okay. The bottom line is that was a very moving, very informative, and inspiring video. Many just facts that were stated there we knew, and there's some other things that we did not know. But I think that if we could somehow galvanize that video across the
internet
or whatever, that would give us a lot more support. Because one young lady said in her prayer that she's looking for more participants, more members. That would cause people to come and join us. because they're going to see in that video what they can do to eradicate that from happening again. Thank you.
Could I respond to what you just said? I think that what you said was great, Alan. But what I think is a case for reparations, because it is now the biggest, Wall Street is the biggest financial area in the entire world. And they started it off about blood. They did. So I think that it's a case for reparations. Any other comments or questions about it?
No.
You sure?
I just want to say I thank you for the video. And these need to be documented and put in history books. I was a PTA president. Yes. And everything that they teach our kids is about, you know, only black things they show us is George Washington Carver, the Underground Railroad. It's like very minimum. They don't tell us. Aside from the traffic light. I mean, there's so many things, the washing machine, all this technology, black people have done it also. The filament and the light bulbs and everything, that was done by black people. That wasn't by a person of non-color. But I'm very grateful to be here today. And I think this thing needs to be shared worldwide. And I think if we get this on Facebook, even this video from this group, it will educate a lot of people, because people are home now. They are always on their TVs. They are always on their cell phones. They are always on their computers and laptops, if you may. And I think the word needs to get out. This is what happened right here in New York, because everybody, most of the people think that slavery was just down in the South. There were slaves.
Reverend Stewart, may I please also add that I don't know how many of you were born here in New York.
I was.
Okay,
I was.
You were, I was, and I'm sure several of us were. They have never, ever taught us anything like this.
Never, ever, no.
Word about it. We never heard anything about any of that.
And also, hello? I wanted to add to it, my parents were very old. My parents were born in 1917 and 1915. And back in the way they were raised, it was like, don't say anything, hush, keep it under the rug. And the mentality, I recall my grandmother sitting with me saying, how they were born, and they had to pick cotton and everything, even if they could barely walk. And so I got on-hand history, not the book history, but it needs to be passed down from generation to generation. And it needs to be taught like the Bible. Don't add anything to it, and don't take anything away from it.
Nice.
We need to document it, take videos of our elders. I appreciate all the things that my parents have done and my grandparents, but I appreciate them sitting down with us. We don't sit at the table and speak anymore. Everybody's got a meal to go and no family time. Everybody's got to do something. And once we get the family back to sit down, and this is what's happening now with this coronavirus, it's making people do what they are uncomfortable doing. That they've gotten out of the norm of saying grace before they eat, sitting at the table with their children, domestic violence is up. A lot of kids are being abused because people are frustrated, but we have been doing this all along. Our parents took care of us and our relatives took care of us. And a lot of people were taught right in their kitchen. My grandmother used to read without a light with her finger reading. She could read that Bible. Third grade education, she could read the Bible. She couldn't pronounce a lot of words, but she was finger reading. I said, you don't have to turn the light off. We have money to pay the bills. You don't have to hide anymore, Grandma. And so this is really a good thing. My parents are from South Carolina. My father's from Lugoff, South Carolina. I'm a relative of Brooke Benton and also Wilson Pickett. And they've stole a lot of the music from our black artists and taking a lot of things away from us, but they can't take away our God. Amen.
Okay, Reverend, that's the next.
Hello. Hello.
Yes, can you hear me? Speaking.
Can you, Bill Seraille, William Seraille.
Okay.
Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Yeah, I just want to remind people, you know, City Park was occupied right now.
Yes.
That was the place where they executed slaves who were rebellious. Right down there by City Hall, yes. By Brooklyn. That's where they executed slaves who were in rebellion.
The burial ground?
It's south of the burial ground, but probably would have been part of the burial ground, but it's where you have City Park by the City Hall, where the mayor and the government meets, City Council meets. There's a park right there. And that's where they executed rebellious slaves. So anytime you walk by it, you can imagine what happened there in 1712 and 1741.
Yeah, one thing I want to like to know, Dr. Seraille, have you been to the Museum of the City of New York?
I've been there a couple of times, yes.
Do they have any of this documented there?
Not that I can speak of, no.
Okay, we have to change that. That has got to be changed because, as far as I knew, slavery was in South Carolina or and beyond, you know, down the South or Missouri or someplace else. They didn't say a darn thing. When I went there, and I think you have to all go, if you're born here, you have to go to that museum at some time, third grade, fifth grade, or something like that. And I never saw anything mentioned about African-Americans being in this city at all until they came up with the, you know, when my parents and all the rest of them came from the South. That's all I heard. Okay, so if there's no further comments, we're gonna go on to the next video, which is very brief. It's 5 minutes. It's called The Untold Story of Slavery in New York.
Must be having a little bit of a...
Can you hear me?
Yeah. Okay, here we go.
There's a long shadow over America's past, slavery. We all know that the North and South fought over it, but many Americans don't know that slavery also existed in our biggest northern city. Jen is here with this amazing story.
Haley, we're talking about New York City. A new exhibition takes a close look at slavery in New York, and we have a personal tour. A photo of a real slave named Caesar welcomes visitors to the exhibition Slavery in New York.
One of his most important accomplishments is that he lives 115 years. He lives enormously long, and yet, even after emancipation, he dies a slave. The history of slavery in New York is very, very varied.
Sidette Harry is a guide with the New York Historical Society.
Welcome to New Amsterdam. New Amsterdam is the original name of the New York colony. The first people to settle here are the Dutch, and they named it after a Dutch city.
Before it became the most populated city in America, New York was, well, a forest. The Dutch needed to clear the land in order to start building. So they brought in slaves from Africa to do the work. These copper figures symbolize those slaves.
They're meant to represent people carrying building materials. A big part of slave labor is going to be building the city, building the wall.
The wall is now Wall Street. Today, it's famous for being the heart of the most important financial district in the world. But back in the early 1600s, this small area was the entire colony. The slaves lived outside of the wall in the land of the blacks. That's where they also had a cemetery. In 1991, construction workers accidentally found that African burial ground, and historians put more time into researching slavery in New York. They hope people come to see the show.
I would hope that they would recognize that the landmarks that they take for granted were built by the labor of people who came here under the most tragic of circumstances.
Just like in the South,
life was hard for slaves. When the English arrived, they made it harder. They created strict laws to keep slaves in their place in the colony they now called New York.
If you take a look at this well, what you'll see is the representations of four women stance talking across. Now, by this time, it is illegal for African Americans to meet in groups of more than three.
So they would sneak and talk while doing their work.
You gonna ask me what?
The exhibit shows just how hard slave labor was. Visitors are asked to pick up this bucket. Weights make it as heavy as it would be if it were full of water. Also on display, the tools used by slaves to make homes beautiful for their masters.
It also became fashionable for the wealthy in New York to have slaves in their households, dressed in reasonable finery and doing domestic work. But slaves continued to do heavy, unpleasant labor throughout.
Slavery officially ended in New York in 1827, long before it was abolished down south. These lifelike figures represent actual 19th century African American New Yorkers. After 200 years, slaves were finally allowed to walk free down the streets of New York. The only city that had more slaves than New York was Charleston, South Carolina.
Want news you can use?
Okay.
Thank you, Zebulon. Okay, that's more about the untold story of slavery in New York. Any comments or questions about that presentation?
Yes, go ahead.
Yes, I would like to comment. This is Jimmy, a member of SALH. I can't see the video, but I was able to hear it. But it's like our founder, Carter G. Woodson, created the book, Miseducation of the Negro. And that's what our problem is, that we've been miseducated about what's been going on in the schools. We never learned anything through the schools or anything through our own knowledge that what we were taught was wrong. But the information is out there today, you know, and we do know the problems that we have and had, and we need to grow from it. And that's one of the main things that I found about the video. It's not telling us the truth. They talked about people that were Africans. Who told us we were Africans?
We were Indian, three of Africans.
Who told us we were Africans? That's my question. But, you know, that's the part of the miseducation that we've got. We were always here. So we need to look at that and move forward, because those people in those burial grounds were the indigenous people, not the people from Africa brought here. Remember, they sold Manhattan for $24. Who did they buy it from, supposedly? The information is there. So research the information, and, you know, that light bulb will come on, and then we'll have a lot more questions. Thank you.
Referring to...
okay.
Ivan Van Sertima, came before Columbus.
Who's speaking?
That's Zebulon, sorry.
Okay. Yeah, so that was any more questions or comments about the untold story of slavery in New York City?
Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Brother Reverend Shoulders here.
Mm-hmm.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
All right. From the scriptures, we see that our ancestors, by Christ's, Christ Jesus, were letting them know that they were hypocrites for the way that, as the parent race, they did one another when he simply told us to love on one another. And I believe his chastisement to make us last, the first last, the parent race last, which all of the other races came out of us. When you look at the palm of your hand, the soles of your feet, we had the leopard children, and the albino children, and our ancestors were so wicked and torturing them and sacrificing them to Molech and all of these idol gods and all of this wicked stuff, that now this third renaissance, fast forwarding it up to now, where all of the, you know, slave trade, the Willie Lynch, divide and conquer stuff is being exposed. And all of that transatlantic stuff where they brought the Africans over to breed them here with the Indians in America to get stronger breeds of slaves, and all of that stuff with the people of color. And so, you know, these things can be looked into even more vividly and in more detail by us, each one reach one, each one teach one. But we just got to really, under the King of Kings, Kings with the small K, that's us brothers, and the King of the Queens, that's the sisters. We really got to look at what the Lord said to our ancestors, the parent race, who caused this to come on us. And now we've gone through that filtering process of chastisement. And now the Lord is having all nations come to obey him, as we see with this COVID-19 and this George Floyd movement. So, you know, just to really look at the thing holistically, from the biblical foundation to the realities and the realization of the realities of spiritualities, as we're on this video chat, that's like a briefing on what the Lord has shown us. Because of his love, he is chastising the whole world by way of the same breath of life which he breathed into Adam and made him a living soul and made all of us on the planet soul brothers and soul sisters. But our task is to remember to remind one another of that. And that's what's happening now with this third sort of a renaissance period that's taking place in lieu of what we're facing right here and now. So I got a lot of, you know, revelation out of what I was listening to and hearing what was being said. And that's just some of the ways to emerge and gel and keep the movement going for the abolishment, the abolition of mental, spiritual, physical, financial slavery, because systemic things that have been going on are now being revealed and being exposed to the point where we can balance out. And the Bible gives us to know that all nations will obey, that every day would be the Sabbath. Every day would be the Sabbath, and the Sabbath will have no end. And they're realizing that we are soul brothers and soul sisters from the same breath of life that the Lord breathed into Adam and made us living souls. So it's coming to that now. And we just got to keep the movement going, keep the momentum going with this third renaissance. And, you know, expose all of the officers and all of the unions of the police department that taking guilt-free ego trips and doing this martial law and this resigning because they can't kill us like they did in the days of old. And that exposes them, and they bring it on themselves to let us know that they've all been in cahoots as first degree premeditated murderers to stand up there and resign when they're told they can't kill us anymore.
Preach, brother, preach.
Yeah, so, you know, I'm in love with my Hebrew people, from the Hebrew to the Negro, to what pastor, I call it pastor, but Dr. Bessie Jackson has always said, the colors are black, they call them yellow, they call them red, the Indians, you know, all of those systemic things are coming to fruition. They're coming to be exposed. They're surfacing for us not to play patty cake with it anymore. Get rid of the 1% of white supremacy, that keyword white, the target words, the silly words they use, like Reverend Beck, I could call the Reverend Bessie Jackson, that's my God sister, soul sister, the love, you know, they got that word, the token word, their heart, white, They've been whitewashed. The pink people, when you look at our palms of our hands, the soles of our feet, they came out of us, who are not brainwashed anymore, who are coming out of the mythology of whitewash and whiteout and all that garbage, lies and trash.
That's right.
Bringing us to the point where we're getting rid of all of the people that have been called hypocrites by Christ on the planet before, and now we call them the itis, the N-word. We got the N-itis and the jigaboos and the sambos and the house niggas and the turncoats. We got to realize that they're going to be filtered out, and they are being filtered out as we speak. Amen. And the reality is the only way to serve Jesus is in spirit and truth. And these truths are coming out. These truths are coming out to the point where the souls of us that are touching and agreeing right now, lifting up the name of Jesus, he's drawing the whole world through the George
Floyd. All people unto him.
Through the corona. He's chastising, he's spanking the whole world. So we are encouraged that we have this second celebration. I see it, Sister Jackson, as the abolishment of slavery from the time we've been back when our hair was black and I first met you like that.
Amen.
And now amen. You, thank you, Reverend Shoulders. You almost did your own prayer already.
It's a lifestyle. It's a lifestyle. It's a lifestyle that, you know, I desire for us to have, and I'm praying. I'm not playing.
No, we're going to get that. We're going to get that. You know, one thing, too, about the video that I didn't realize, we built that wall on Wall Street, I'm sure. They was built under the direction of that Dutch governor, but I'm sure that our labor built that as we built everything else down there. Yeah. But let's move along for the sake of time. I want to thank for all the great comments. Thank Mr. Williams and thanking Reverend Shoulders for that. You hold on to that prayer, Reverend. And I would like to hear now from Lucille Boles.
Okay, finally.
Oh, finally.
But I haven't eaten lunch yet, and it's like 2 hours. So before I start on what I want to talk about, I had a town hall meeting the other day, and only one person came in. Now, what I have to do, I have to find from the group what day y'all want to hold my town hall meeting, because every politician that I know is going to come there. I'm inviting News 12, News 1, Bronxnet already trained me on how to do the real Zoom, okay? And I need a recorder, and I need a host. I will be the host. I'm gonna ask Avril from the Cancer Foundation to be my recorder, because like you said, that young man that was assisting you,
exactly. I
can't do it and record at the same time. I'm gonna have the Bronx Free Press. I'm gonna have everybody there. I need a date for you guys to give me a date that you could come.
Okay,
it's almost July now.
Okay, you need to clarify what you're asking for, because
asking for a town hall when everybody was at this meeting, along with my news media and all the politicians that I know. And
I'm going to talk about specifically.
I'm going to give a meeting about the flyer that you sent me, the celebration day of the abolition of slavery. Now, everybody wasn't on. Now, I can either do this on Facebook and invite you people to come on, or I can do it on Zoom and split the screen where I can see who's gonna talk. If you want me to do it on Facebook, remember, Dr. Dana, you told me I was, and Bessie Jackson told me I can run with it. I've been running with it. The only problem is I sent out invites and they never received them.
Well, I wanna apologize, I never saw it.
I've been in contact with Gary Preslow. I've been in contact with Senator Bailey. I've been in contact with Carl Hastings. And they all know that I'm on a warpath to get this bill signed by the governor. But the man is very busy. And my father taught me the way to get to the man is through the woman, so I'm calling Matilda. Matilda's his mother.
All right.
And I'm calling the lieutenant governor.
So we can get the bill signed.
I got all their emails. If y'all want to come on, it's going to be on the 25th of August, the day before my virtual fashion show. Now, if that's too soon, within September.
Now, that seems like a good time for most, I would think. I'm not sure. But let me see. I think there's a reaction button here.
It's a Tuesday.
If, If you're for it, just clap your hands on the reaction button. Press your reaction button if you want to come out.
It's gonna be a virtual.
I mean, on the Zoom.
On Zoom.
I don't see it. Did you see mine? I don't know. Well, anyway, send out the Zoom meeting, and then we'll know.
And I'm a do a preliminary on Facebook to let everybody in the public know about it also. But I don't want the public, because there's so many people that come on here, you know, because when you go public, you know, you get some characters on there that you don't want to be on. And if you want to speak, you have to let me know 1 month in advance. So that's the end of this month if you want to be a guest speaker.
Sell a date again, please.
August the 25th.
What time?
It's going to be at 6:00 in the evening.
Okay.
And I'm gonna try, and Brian Benjamin, I know him personally. So you know I have to ask him. And yes. And Reverend Al Taylor, I already spoke to him. Okay. And then I'm also gonna invite the Brooklyn Borough President, the Manhattan Borough President, and the Boogie Down Bronx Borough President.
What about the what's his name? Jamal, the new Jamal.
Well, yeah, I got Jamal, I got Senator Bailey down.
No, not Senator Bailey.
Paul Hastings and Gary Petno, because their names are in this
Bill.
The guy who was just got the nomination, the Jamal Bryant, I think his name.
Bowman.
Excuse me.
Yeah.
Look at him and find out what he's about.
Yeah, really, because nobody knows him. But anyway, thank you so much.
Until now.
I know him.
You know him? Who's that? Who said they know him?
Zebulon.
Okay, Zebulon, we'll speak later because we don't want to take this time. We want to finish our chat. So I want to thank Ms. Boles. Could you give us a closing remark for your presentation?
Okay, my closing remark is this. I'm from the Boogie Down Bronx, and I'm so upset. I'm so upset because the governor put his John Hancock to this. He put his John Hancock to... What's the name of that
Juneteenth.
Juneteenth. Right. But Ms. Jackson worked very hard since 2017 on this. And I'm told Ms. Jackson that I'm going to push this to my dying breath. All my cast is going to say she tried. But it's not a try. I'm going to do this. You know why? It's not what you know. It's who do you know? And who do I know? They don't want to hear
everybody.
My mind. Everybody. Everybody. Yes.
I back you up on that. I know you do.
Young Hams, listen to this now. Yeah. The Young Hams are the one that work for the politicians, and I know all the Young Dems. Okay?
Thank you so much.
That's what I have to say. Okay. God bless you. I love you, and Pastor, I'll talk to you later if he's
okay.
Still there.
So let's move along. I'm going to take the time right now. I want to ask Zebulon, would you please show Seneca Village? I want to say that there has been slavery in New York, and that slavery had been abolished, and we have been trying to establish ourselves in a variety of ways. But I want you to see how what happens. It's sort of like a Black Wall Street, so to speak, here in New York City. Please watch this next video, Seneca Village, African Americans in Early New York.
We're in Central Park, surrounded by beautiful old trees, by lawns, playgrounds, rock outcroppings of Manhattan schist, a reminder of the glacier that once towered over this area, all landmarks that New Yorkers know well. What is less known is that just below our feet are the traces of Seneca Village.
Seneca Village was an African-American and Irish community that was founded in the mid-1820s, and it continued to exist until the park was created in the 1850s. Everybody was evicted from their homes in Seneca Village in 1857.
Which is why very few people know about its existence now in the 21st century.
We've been working on a project to discover the history of Seneca Village and to give Seneca Village its place in history, which has been almost forgotten.
Seneca Village is especially important when you consider the place of African Americans in New York's early history, going all the way back to the Dutch settlement, but also as the English took over and in the post-revolutionary era.
I think a lot of us assume that the African American presence began with the Great Migration in the early 20th century. However, the first African Americans arrived here in the mid-1620s with the Dutch colonists. And African Americans have had a strong presence ever since.
Many people forget that there was slavery here, that much of New York was built with enslaved labor.
We had slavery here in New York until 1827, when emancipation finally was completed.
And in fact, sadly, slavery continued in New York until 1841.
After 1827, when emancipation was completed for New Yorkers, it was still possible, if you were a slave owner from out of state, to bring your slaves as property into the state until 1841.
New York, because it became the financial center of the United States, had important financial ties to the South and to slavery. And so much of the wealth that came into New York was derived from slave labor.
So many of the merchants in New York City depended on crops that were grown in the South, cotton and other work, to export to England for the milk.
Which makes it all the more important to retrieve the history of African Americans in New York City.
To realize that it's something that's deeply embedded in the city's history.
But not that deeply embedded below our feet. The traces of Seneca Village, the traces of this African American settlement in what was then a rural area north of New York City, what is now Central Park, is just a few feet below the soil. This had been a farm that was parceled out soon after the commissioner's plan, what is known as the grid plan of New York, was laid out. Individual parcels for individual houses were set out for sale.
Those parcels were sold, in some cases, to African Americans. There were a lot of landowners in the city who would not sell land to African Americans, so this provided an enormous opportunity.
The purchase of land not only bought you a piece of property, one also was purchasing the right to vote.
There was an amendment to the New York State Constitution that said that if you were an African American male, you would be able to vote if you owned $250 or more property and if you had resided in New York for more than 3 years.
And of course, you had to be male.
And we also think that it was a Black middle class community.
We know, for example, that skilled tradesmen worked here. We've identified one of the inhabitants as a cooper, that is, as a man who made barrels.
To be a member of the Euro-American middle class, one had to have a job which did not involve manual labor. That was not true for African Americans because African Americans were discriminated against to such an extent that they didn't have that possibility.
And so perhaps there was another value in having a village that was at some distance from the settled area lower on Manhattan Island.
The village allowed the Seneca villagers to have a controlled, peaceful community of their own away from that harassment.
And it wasn't just homes. There were numerous churches, there was at least one school, and several graveyards. This was a true community. By the mid-century, the increasing density of the urban population in lower propelled this idea that New York was one of the great cities of the world. The problem was there were people living in the area where the park was to be built, including Seneca Village. And so the state of New York used its legal power, its powers of eminent domain, to condemn the properties within the boundaries of the park and to evict the residents.
And they did that with the idea of creating something for the greater good. Really tragic. And coincidentally, at the time, was a moment when there was a horrible economic depression in New York. It was a very hard time to lose your home and to have to start over again.
We know from census records that there were more than 250 people that lived in Seneca Village at its height. And this included not only African Americans, but also European immigrants.
At the time that everybody had to move, two-thirds of the population was African American, but one-third of it was of European descent, mostly Irish.
And this makes sense, because this is in the years immediately after the potato famine and the great wave of immigrants that left Ireland for the U.S. What I find most troubling is that the very memory of the village was virtually lost.
Until the very late 1980s and early 1990s, Seneca Village was gone from popular memory.
So it's only towards the end of the 20th century that the memory of Seneca Village is resurrected. And thanks to the field work that you and your team undertook, we can much more accurately locate that history in place and with artifacts.
The artifacts that we found are really important because we can imagine the people of Seneca Village having during their meals. We can look at their dishes and see that they were similar in terms of their patterns to people of European descent and how they were different.
So by locating the foundations of the homes, of the churches, of the remains of the graveyards, by locating some of the artifacts, these allow us to reinsert this important chapter of American history back into our cultural consciousness.
To make African Americans part of the larger narrative of American history.
Okay. Thank you. When I saw that personally, I want to make a comment. It's like, what? You know, how many years have I gone down to Central Park to hang out and never knew that there were, it was an enclave for middle-class African-Americans in the 1800s or 1900s as such. I'm not quite sure of the span, but it's another Black Wall Street of sorts that happened right here in New York City, right in Central Park, where all of us, I can say 100% of us have been there, and we've sat there with our family and our children and taking them to the zoo and things like that. I had my son at a Flower Fifth Avenue Hospital overlooking that park, never knowing that that was a place that we used to have homes. And through eminent domain, we lost them. Any other comments or questions?
I appreciate these videos. I'm going to pass them on to the principal where I was the PTA president, Middle School 35 in Brooklyn, New York. I'm the mayor over here in Bed-Stuy, they call me.
Okay.
We have to give out this information. We have to pass it on. The ministers have to pass it on to their church leaders, our youth departments. And it's very touching. It's very moving. What got me was that man lived over 100 and some years and died as a slave.
Yes, Caesar.
My question is, does anyone have information as to his lineage that has gone on? And that would be very interesting to follow his family or have information for other people.
More than likely, it's here in the city records. I would say it's in the city records. It just has to be looked up.
No, but I'm just saying it would be interesting and very knowledgeable to have one of their relatives.
Yes.
That would be beautiful. Awesome.
That's a great idea. Thank you, Reverend. Any other comments or questions about the last video?
I just wanted to say thank you, everybody. There's so many folks I haven't met yet, but I'm looking forward to the opportunity. And I think it's wild when you realize just how late slavery was ended in New York compared to, my dad is from New York, but I grew up in Boston, my mother's family's from. And you know, it's a lot earlier, not a lot, but comparatively earlier there. And so I think for that reason alone is what makes our struggle to create this holiday distinctive and important, because it's either New Jersey or New York is the last state. I think New Jersey has that title, but it's gotta be New York second to last to end slavery in the North. And you know, all the history, as many people have pointed out, is there, and it's around us. It's right in the libraries in our communities, in our, you know, in Manhattan and also in Brooklyn where I live also, in Bushwick. And we have to, you know, take the opportunities to find them out there. I know they called New Jersey the northernmost southern state. Mm-hmm. You know, that up south kind of thing. And then Woodrow Wilson, you know, who was president of Princeton and all that, but they just changed, you know, stopped using his name at Princeton. So you see that things are really changing. And in terms of really targeting this northern stuff, so I think our work, our fight here is totally on time and valid, And people might say, well, we have Juneteenth now, but we have to say, no, this is about slavery in the North and the longer struggle there and what that all meant. So I just think it's really, really relevant.
Thank you, Zebulon. Any other comments? Someone, is that Ernest?
I just want to say that was a wonderful presentation about Seneca Falls. That was great. It was wonderful. Very enlightening.
Yeah, it was. I had no idea that I was playing over our some of our people's ex-homes, you know. And they were middle class, and they just destroyed it, just like that. Mm-hmm. And they had the right to vote and all of that. I wonder if once their properties were taken, was their right to vote taken away as well? So there are lots of questions. Mm-hmm. And who benefited from that? And where did those people go after they were, you know, just relocated as such?
Yeah.
Thank you, Ernest. Okay. Any other hello. Comments? Because we're hello. To the end of our presentation. Yes.
Hello.
Yes.
It's William Seraille.
Hi, Dr. Seraille.
You're asking about the vote. New York allowed African Americans to vote until 1821, and then the state constitution made it difficult. You had to be have a certain amount of property, at least $250 worth of property.
Right.
Which most people did not have. So that's why most African Americans in New York could not vote until you had the 15th Amendment, 1870.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And as a result, I mean, there are a lot of efforts from 1822 to 1870 to get the state legislature to do it, which did not do. And then they asked the voters to approve of referendums to allow African Americans to vote, but it always failed. So unless those people who were there had property, they could not vote.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Seraille.
And as to where they left after the village got destroyed, I'm not sure. They may have gone to Brooklyn, because a lot of people would go to Brooklyn after the 1863 riots by the Irish against the African American citizens in New York City. So they may have gone across the river to Brooklyn.
Right. I know some people who are seventh generation Brooklynites, and they probably came up out of that Seneca Village situation as well.
Yeah, you had that community called Waitsville.
Right, I heard about it. I know direct descendant from there.
Yeah, so that's probably where they went. They probably went to Brooklyn.
Right. Thank you so much, Dr. Seraille. Okay. All right, folks, so we've been on this journey since 12 noon, and we're about to end this journey. If there's nothing pressing that someone has to say, then we're going to ask Reverend Shoulders to pray. Is there anyone who wants to say something that you had not a chance to say? Yes.
I believe our sister who had spoken in the beginning, Mother, it says Amber Green on her screen.
That's Mother, that's Mrs. Jackson.
Ms. Jackson, thank you, okay. I believe she would like to say something, if I'm not mistaken, but...
Okay, Mrs. Jackson?
But she's muted. You are muted right now.
Okay, unmute Ms. Jackson.
Okay.
She has to unmute herself.
Ah, now I see. Okay, she'll be able to unmute. She is unmuted, I believe. Oh, no. Ask to unmute. Okay. Try it now. If you unmute, it may not have worked before, but it should work now.
Okay.
I'm just going to unmute everybody, I guess, so we can hear her.
Mm-hmm.
That's not quite get it for some reason. I'm so sorry. asked to unmute. Mother Jackson, it should have should be asking you to, it should say host has asked you to unmute.
Press that, or.
I think maybe somebody's helping out.
Okay, thank you. There we go.
Okay, thank you very much. I just want everybody to realize that we have a bill in Albany just waiting to be signed by the legislators. This bill has been in there for a year now. But what we are trying to do, of course, is get a New York State holiday in commemoration of the abolition of slavery. So this bill is the abolition commemoration bill. And this is not what the governor signed already.
Signed Juneteenth.
Yeah, Juneteenth. He didn't speak to us, although we'd been writing to him, letting him know that we have chosen the second Monday in July. You see, slavery did not end in New York in June anyway. So, you know, we have to make sure that the governor gets it right.
Right. So we need to get on this meeting.
To write to the governor and give him the facts as far as New York State's history is concerned, so that he won't think that he can tell us to celebrate a different month and under somebody else's program.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay. We have our own program and, of course, our own state. Every state had a different history in terms of So we must school the governor because he's not the only one who was not properly schooled, but obviously hasn't been properly schooled.
We'll school him. There's no doubt about that. And yes. I want to thank everyone for coming on this program today. It's been a wonderful holiday celebration. Next year, when we come together, we should be sitting someplace or having some wonderful things to do, great prayers and food to eat and things like that. Mm-hmm.